Hello, this is Professor Umara from RV College of Engineering. In this session, we will discuss something about contingency analysis. So in the previous lecture, I discussed about what is the meaning of security, why security is needed, and the different levels of operating states in the power system. So we saw that when a contingency occurs, then with suitable control action, maybe we can run the system without loss of load, or sometimes we cannot run it without loss of load. So load shedding may become an integral part of the control action. So we will study how we rate the contingencies and how we prepare for them in this lecture. So the power system security, we can break it down into two major functions. The first is security assessment. So this gives the level of the security operating state. So I have to assess, am I in level 1, which is very secure, or level 2, which is secure, but then if a contingency occurs, I have to take some control action. Or am I in the controllable emergency or uncontrollable emergency or in the restorative state? So I have to make an assessment of the state of the system. And I told you this can be done by taking suitable measurements from the system parameters. So these measurements are done using SCADA, and in the modern power systems, a lot of IoT is present. IoT stands for Internet of Things. So different intelligent devices in the system are connected, and via the internet, the data acquisition takes place. So this is the first part of security, assessing the level. The second aspect is the security control. So what appropriate control measure should I take within the constraints to keep my target security level? So these are the two major functions. So these are executed at the control center, because as I told you, all the data comes to a central control center where the decisions are taken. Now, the static security level of a power system, that based on the different states we saw, is characterized by the presence of emergency operating conditions. That is where you are very close to limit violations, or you have already violated the limits. In its actual state, that means the present state, pre-contingency or potential post-contingency. I told you that contingency is a preparation. It's like an insurance. In the event of something bad occurring, how am I prepared? That is what is a contingency. It may occur or it may not occur, so I have to plan for it. That's the meaning of potential. Potential means in the future. So, is my security compromised in the present state itself? We saw that some state, in a state, operating state itself, some limits are violated. Okay? Or would my limits be compromised when a contingency occurs? Okay? So, the security assessment is the process by which such violations are detected. If it is in the present state, it can be detected directly by measurements. If it's in the future, the contingency analysis has to be run. You have to run a program for foreseeing what would happen in the eventuality of a disturbance occurring. Now, the assessment itself involves two functions. One is monitoring, which is data acquisition, and the second is contingency analysis. So contingency means, I told you, fault, emergency, analysis. So what do we do in contingency analysis? I first define, and then I select which are the worst, and then I evaluate what can be done. So the first function, the contingency definition, will give you the list of contingencies to be processed whose probability of occurrence is very high. So this you can know from statistical operation of the system. It could be based on the geographical area of the system. It could be based on the nature of loads which are going to be connected to the system and so on. Okay. So in my previous lecture, I discussed the N minus 1 criteria, where the system should be robust and stable under loss of a single generator or a single major transmission line. So first I define what are all the contingencies which I have to study. That is the first phase. Next is selection. So all these faults may not have a very grave impact on the system operation. Okay. So what do? I rank them in the order of severity. Okay. So contingency rank, it's called as contingency ranking. 1, 2, 3, 4. Rank them in the order of their severity. For this ranking, you would have realized by now that for any contingency, I have to run the load flow, because my state of the system is completely determined by the load flow. The power flows, the voltages, the reactive power flow, active power flow, everything is determined by the load flow. Okay. So a conventional load flow like your Newton-Raphson method or even an FDLF would take some computation time. So for the first screening of the contingencies, we use what is called as the DC load flow. I'll present to you in the next one or two slides what it is. So the DC load flow is the simplest load flow you can have. And we can use the DC load flow for an initial selection of the worst contingencies. Worst means which are the contingencies which are very severe and which are going to lead to major violations, limit violations in the system. So first I define, that means I make a list of all the contingencies I want to study, and then I select the most severe of them. You have to decide depending on the grid whether you want to select the top 10 or 20 or what you want to do. And the third one is evaluation. So once I have shortlisted the severe ones, then these contingencies, I pick them up and do a detailed AC analysis. I run an AC load flow or a power flow. And then again, I rearrange them in the order of their severity. Okay. So now with the AC load flow, I'll get a complete detailed picture. So please remember, you will be doing a lot of this is post disturbance occurrence, post contingency occurrence. So what are you going to do with it? I am going to find out which are my most severe disturbances in the system, and then rank them and keep them. And I have a control action ready. Okay. So so all this is the first assessment part. I do all this in the assessment part. Then once I have the list of contingencies, for each contingency, I chart out a plan of action. Okay, if this occurs, what will I do? I will shed 10% of the load in area 1. Or I will increase the generation in area 2 by 10%. Okay, so this is the kind of action plan I would have ready. Right, so now what you should understand is, in your present operating state, you are deciding this. Okay, so the contingency may occur or may not occur. It's only a preparation. You're preparing for the worst. Now, if the contingency does not occur, maybe after half an hour or 1 hour, what would happen is your operating state would change. The system load would have changed. Probably something would have happened at the generation level. A transformer might have been de-energized. So the system state changes. So then what do? Now you have to prepare a new set of contingencies, the new list, which is more severe. So what is not severe in one operating condition may become a severe in another operating condition. Again, let us take a simple example. Supposing you have a 500 megawatt generator supplying 200 megawatts of power, an increase of 100 megawatts, no problem. The generator can pick it up. Right? So for this operating condition, an increase of 100 megawatts is perfectly acceptable. But supposing the generator were already supplying around 410 or 420 megawatts, now an increase of 100 megawatts would overload the generator. Clear? So what is the effect of my disturbance will depend on what state I am in. It will not have the same effect in all states. Okay. Therefore, this contingency analysis is not a one-time run. You don't run it and keep it and say, I'm ready. No, it has to be done periodically at the control system. It's a dynamic application. As and when the system state changes, we may have to reorder the contingencies and so on. Okay. So the security control aspect is going to be to help you to be prepared to meet the contingency. So now we will see what is this DC load flow. That is a model we use for the initial contingency screening. Right. So now you are all familiar with the FDLF method for load flow. So the fast decoupled load flow method basically solves for these two matrix equations. Okay. Here delta P is the change in the active power between the specified value and the calculated value, and delta Q is the change in the reactive power between the specified value and the calculated value. The first set of equations you would be solving at all the P, Q and PV buses. And the second set of equations is for the PQ buses. So now what are these elements? So B dash is BIK, an element of B dash, B prime. BIK is equal to minus of 1 by XIK if there is a branch between I and K, else it is 0. And BII dash is sigma k is equal to 1 to n of 1 by xik. So xik is the impedance of the branch between nodes I and k. Similarly, b double dash ik is minus bik, that's equal to minus xik by rik squared plus xik squared, and b double dash ii is also defined. So all these elements do not change. They are not dynamic in nature. Why? They're all dependent only on the line reactants. Okay. So this is not an iterative method. You can do it in one shot. Okay. And you don't have to update B dash. These equations have to be solved iteratively, but B dash and B double dash don't have to be updated in every iteration. They're not iterative. You just calculate them at the beginning of the load flow, and these matrices remain a constant. And you only solve iteratively for delta, change in the angle delta and change in the voltage magnitude. That's the reason why fast decoupled load flow are very, very popular. Okay. Now, we further simplify this as follows. First, I drop the QV equations totally. Okay. I'm not bothered about the reactive power flow. Next, I assume all the voltage magnitudes to be equal to 1 per unit. Okay, so then I get this. Delta P is equal to P dash into delta delta. Right? So very simple to solve. This equation considers the angle change of all the buses except the swing bus. Swing bus, remember, is the reference bus whose angle is assumed to be a constant. So this solution is my DC load flow. This is simple one matrix equation where I solve for delta delta, a one-shot solution. Right? So this is called as the DC load flow. Now, let's see what this can do. The DC load flow is useful to calculate the megawatt flows on transmission lines and transformers. Okay? It does not tell you what happens to the voltage magnitudes because I have assumed everything to be 1, or the reactive power or the apparent power. It only tells you about the active power. Okay, I can calculate the active power flow in any line using this simple formula. PIK is equal to 1 by XIK delta I minus delta K. So if you recollect, the active power flow between two buses is VI VK divided by XIK into delta I minus delta K. Now here I am assuming VI and VK to be equal to 1 per unit. So I get a very simple expression for active power flow. Okay, so as a first screening, what we do, we solve the DC load flow for different contingencies and find out for each power flow which is going to be severely impacted, which line is going to be severely impacted. Okay, so now what contingencies should I do? So the first is the contingency selection. Which do I select to rank? Okay, so the first method is called as direct method. Direct method. So in the selection, before the selection, in the definition, as I told you, we would be studying the effect of the loss of the generators, each of the generators, and loss of the major transmission lines. These are the two most severe faults. And for each loss, using a preliminary DC load flow, for each loss, using a preliminary DC load flow, I compute what are the lines which are going to be overloaded and then try to see which is the most severe. So I shortlist out of all the contingencies, I shortlist and pick up the most severe ones, some part of it. So then from here, to rank them, what do I do? There is first a direct method. So this involves a direct ranking of the contingency cases by monitoring appropriate post-contingent quantities. So what do? I run the load flow. I monitor what is happening post-contingency. What do I monitor? I monitor the line flows. I monitor the voltage magnitudes, right? So here, obviously, if you want the voltage magnitudes, after the DC load flow, have a preliminary screening, then for the most severe ones, you run an AC load flow. And from the AC load flow, we can rank. So there are some things called as performance indices. So you can define your own performance index. What does a performance index look like? So in a performance index, basically I'm trying to capture what is the violation. How much is the deviation? So I have given you two simple commonly used parameters. So this is for megawatt, megawatt deviation. So for all the lines, I calculate the power flow for all the lines. And this is the expression. So in this expression, L is the number of lines. PL is the power flow in line L. PL limit is the limit of power flow in that particular line. WL is a real non-negative weighting factor, because some lines may be more crucial than the others. You may want to give them a different rating. Some lines may not be very critical. Okay, for example, a feeder which is going to supply, let us say, a big hospital. Right. Obviously, you want to give a major ranking weightage to that. So on, you can decide. Okay. And N is a positive integer. N is a positive integer. So if you look at this index, it's going to be a number. Right. So higher the number, what do you understand? You higher the number, you understand that this PL is larger than P limit, far away from the limit. That means there is more of violation. Okay, so these numbers give you an idea. They're all empirical formulas, or something like this could be used. It's a simpler version where I don't have any weighting factor and all the lines are given the same weightage. So there are many indices like this. You can define your own also. We can have a simple index as the magnitude of the voltage minus the limit. So you can just have use simply the deviation of the voltage. So you can have different limits like that. Okay. So based on these performance indexes and what is important to me, I rank the contingencies in the order of their severity. So such methods are called as direct methods. So what am I doing in the direct method? I'm directly running the load flow, detailed load flow after the preliminary screening using DC load flow. And from the load flow results, I evaluate indices and then rank my contingencies. See, as I told you, for an voltage deviation, you can use something like this. So these are weights, again WVI, and VI is the actual voltage minus the specified voltage as a ratio of the limit. So as the deviation is more, this quantity would be more. Okay. Then we have indirect method, where you may not be able to study hundreds and thousands of contingencies that may occur. So what is done is, there are some parameters calculated. These can be calculated offline because they don't depend on the dynamic nature. They depend on the network parameters, that is your impedance, resistance, etc. Okay, so once I have these parameters calculated, then for a given state and a given contingency, I can evaluate what is going to be the effect. Let me tell you what it means. So basically, I told you there are two outages, major outages. One is a generator outage, and another is a line outage. So two types of parameters or factors are computed for the given network. The first is called as the generation shift distribution factors, and the second one is line outage distribution factors. What are these? I'm not going to derive it because that's not the scope of this course, but we will just see what these factors indicate. So the generator shift factor is denoted commonly by ALI. Okay, so L is the subscript and I is the superscript. So this is a number. Again, it's a number. So what does this tell you? This number represents the sensitivity of the power flow in line L to a power change at bus I. Okay, I repeat. The factor ALI tells you what is the sensitivity to a line flow due to a power change in a particular bus I. Why is it important? Let us say there is a generator outage. That means the injection at that bus has changed, right? The power injected into that bus has changed. So because of this, what is the effect on the line flows in the other lines, in all the lines? So how many factors you will have? Let us say you have 10 lines and 5 generators. 10 lines and 5 generators. This would be a 5 by 10 matrix. So every cell, every generator outaged, you will have 10 factors corresponding to each one of the lines. So if you have 5 generators, you will have 5 into 10 matrix. So any generator outage, you can find out what is the sensitivity of the line flow due to that outage in all the lines. Now, how do I use it? So now let us say there is a power change of delta PI at a particular bus I. Then the new power flows, FL new, will be equal to FL old plus the factor, generator distribution factor, into delta PI. Clear? So I can find out what is going to be the new power flows in all the lines, when there is a change at bus I. Okay, how is this useful? Just see here, ALI I have already calculated and kept for all each of the generator, for all the lines. Now when there is a change in a particular bus, outage is the extreme case. Okay, let us take the extreme case. So if the generator were initially supplying a power of PI naught, right? When there is an outage, what is the change? This PI naught becomes zero. So the change is minus PI naught. Okay, that is the change. So I can find out the new power flows, So I run the load flow for my particular operating state. So I have FL old, I have all the parameters. These can be calculated offline and kept because they're all constants. They don't change. They don't keep changing. So I have this parameter. Okay. So now what I do in my present state, I evaluate FL new. What would be the new flows for for every generator outage, right? Then I am prepared. I know if this particular generator, has an outage, these lines, the power falls. These lines, the power flow falls means what? The load they are supplying will suffer. I may have to shed it. Okay. Some line may get overloaded. So I have to think about that. So you get an idea about what control action has to be taken. Okay. So this is about the generator outage. Similarly, we have a line outage distribution factors. Very simple case you take. Supposing I have two parallel lines. Okay. So I'm having a substation and I have two parallel feeders. I have two parallel feeders supplying a load of say 200 megawatts. Both are identical. So 100 megawatt will be flowing through both the feeders. Now supposing there's an outage in one of the feeders, one of the lines. What will happen immediately? The other line will pick up that power and 200 megawatts will flow through the other line. Yes. Now, if that line is capable of carrying 200 megawatts, no problem. But what if it is a 100 megawatt line? That line will get overloaded. Right? So, any line outage will distribute the power so that KCL and KVL are satisfied. Okay? So, the power will be distributed and as a result of which, definitely some lines may get overloaded. So, for this, we have what we call as the line distribution factors denoted by DL of K. This is the distribution factor for line L when line K is experiencing an outage. So if I remove line K, what is the sensitivity in line L? That is what this DLK will indicate. So what will be its size? Supposing I have 10 lines, this will be a matrix of 10 by 10. If I remove line 1, of course, effect on line 1, I have nothing to calculate. I have already removed it. So what is the effect of removing line 1 on 2, 3, 4, 5 up to 10? Okay. Similarly, what is the effect of removing line 2 on the rest? So it will be a 10 by 10 matrix. And you can find the new power flows like this. Okay. FL old plus DLK into FK old. So K is the line which is getting outaged and L is the line of interest. So you run your load flow in your present operating condition, operating state, and you already have all these factors, the generator distribution factors and the line outage distribution factors. So you can immediately calculate what will be the line flows when either a generator or a line, there is a outage. So this is called as an indirect method of contingency assessment. You can make a order based on that. Okay. So the most severe ones are the ones which would violate heavily. Now, the security control function responds to each insecure contingency case usually in decreasing order of severity. So the most severe, when we do a contingency ranking, the most severe, rank number one is the most severe. Understand that. Okay. And it's in decreasing order of ranking. So we may reschedule the pre-contingency operating state. So if I know some contingency is going to really lead my system into trouble, I'll change my present state itself. So that if I am in level 2, I go to level 1. So that contingency doesn't affect me. That is one possible control action you can take. Okay, number one. So it's just like, if you know, for example, people know smoking causes cancer, right? So what I don't smoke, I stop smoking. Clear? That is take. If you know that some contingency is going to be really drastic, you change the operating state itself. Now, that is one possible security control action. The second one is, okay, it is not so severe, but it will have an impact. Then I develop a control strategy. I say, okay, I will shed 10% of the load, or I'll increase this generator, or I'll ask the hydel plants to take this action, something like that. So you have a control action in place. And if the post contingency effect is small, don't do anything. The third one, don't take any action. If it's not going to lead to any major violations, it's not going to have any impact, leave it. Just continue operating. Okay. So a specific security control function is then designed to operate in real time or in study mode, means for analysis, you can use it. You can schedule active or reactive power controls or both. And you can achieve a defined security level, that is level 1 or level 2, which do you want to get. And you can even minimize a defined operator, operational objective. We have seen that, you know, how you can minimize cost, etc. Okay, so we did optimal power flows. And without going into details, I'll just mention here, there's something called SCO, Security Constrained Optimization. So when I do my optimization, optimal power flow itself, I build the security constraints into it. Okay. So contingency cases is analysis is done, and cases with violations or near violations are identified. You identify them, and then the SCO, security constraint optimization problem, is solved, and a rescheduling of active and reactive power controls are repeated until no violations exist. Supposing there's a voltage deviation, you may then increase the reactive power injection at that particular bus. Okay, if a line active power flow is deviating, it is more than the specified value and it is getting overloaded, then you may do some load shedding, you may do some load shedding, and so on. So we can reschedule the active and reactive power flows. Okay, so what we discussed was the problem of security is divided into two. The first is assessment and the second is control. And in assessment, what I do, first I make a list of all the contingencies which I have to study. Then I run a preliminary DC load flow and get the most severe ones. And for the most severe ones, I run an AC load flow. Okay. And then pick up again, I rank them, and then for each of them, I prepare a control action. The control action could be to reschedule in my pre-contingency state itself. That means in my operating state, present operating state, I make some changes, or keep a post-contingency control action ready, or take no action at all if the contingency is insignificant. Thank you.